So who's ready for the first session of the day? Yeah. It is my pleasure to introduce the Canucks session of the day. We are here at Rogers Arena because of generous support from the Vancouver Canucks. But that's not all they've done for mental health in BC and in Canada. They helped launch mindcheck.ca website, which if you've heard of it, it's an early detection website for youth mental health, which has been seen by hundreds of thousands of youth across the province. They helped launch, as mentioned earlier, Hockey Talks campaign for the Canadian NHL teams across the NHL. And they've really helped put mental health on the map in a much bigger way, as is recognized by this day alone.
We are so thrilled to have Wes Rypien here, the brother of former Canuck Rick Rypien. Wes is so passionate about why we are all here today, and we are so grateful that he has come here to speak to us today.
I'd like to introduce TC Carling, who's been a champion for mental health in the province for a number of years now, and is out there really pushing things forward. TC Carling is Senior Vice President of Communications Strategic Partnerships with the Canadian Men's Health Foundation. He's been a successful fundraiser and community leader as Vice President of Communications and Community Partnerships with Canucks Sports and Entertainment over the past 14 years. He helped launch Hockey Talks, an award-winning national mental health initiative.
I also would like to introduce Paul Irving, who has been an incredible and involved youth volunteer with Mental Health Fields. Paul is a student in his fourth year studying psychology at UBC. Over the past couple of years, Paul has been speaking and volunteering with a variety of mental health initiatives and projects in the Vancouver area.
Please welcome TC, Paul, and Wes.
Thank you very much. Like I was introduced, I'm Rick's older brother. I'm also the president of the Ricky Rip Foundation, a foundation that we created in order to continue Rick's legacy through his charitable works. I was asked to speak here, and I'm going to go over a few points regarding my own experience in dealing with Rick's situation, what I've learned, and where I think we need to be as we continue to battle mental health issues. In regards to supporting a sibling, I think the first thing that I need to emphasize is how important it is to gain trust. And, you know, you're asking someone to potentially talk to you and open up to you about what could potentially be their deepest and darkest secrets. In order for that someone who is battling depression or any other mental health issues, you're going to need to earn that trust. I think a common misconception between the two words, deserve and earned, you know, trust isn't deserved, whether you're a friend or a family member, it's earned. And I think the best way, in my experience, to go about that is just to listen and not be judgmental. You know, it's going to be difficult. What I've learned through dealing with Rick's issues is how hard it was and how hard it's going to be. But that doesn't mean that it's not worth, you know, taking that on, staying the course, and continuing to be as proactive as possible, no matter what challenges may present themselves. MindCheck's done a great job in helping bring awareness to not only youth, but you know, people of any age in order to get them to open up about the issues that they're dealing with. Even in my own experience back home, I'm coming from a small town, and amazingly there's still people in that town that I haven't spoken with, and I've been approached by some of these people, and they've told me how much MindCheck has meant to them, how much it's helped, and you know, they've been battling with issues for such a long time, that to see someone like Rick go through the same thing that they went through, and to see how the Canucks and MindCheck and all these other foundations come together and under a common cause has helped them and given them the support they needed open up to their family members in order to seek help. In closing, I think that it's important that we, like I talked about before, stay the course. I mentioned how difficult it is and was, but you know, most good fights that any of us are going to be involved in our lives, it's the hardest ones that are actually worth fighting and continue to fight. So in closing, I'd like to thank you all for letting me speak here briefly. I'd like to thank the Canucks and Minecheck for their continuous support, not only myself and my family. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody, and I'm absolutely honored to be here. I'm honored to be joined by Paul and that Wes would accept our invitation to attend this event. I wanted to give you a little bit of background, not only on the Canucks' participation in an event like today, but in Rick's time with the Canucks, Brent mentioned in my introduction, I spent 14 years with Canucks Sports and Entertainment and was fortunate enough to call this building my office. And during that time, I met incredible people, fans, media, co-workers, many of who are my closest friends. And Rick was very much among the great people that I had an opportunity to meet. Rick joined the Canucks organization in 2006 after a very successful junior hockey career in Regina, and immediately made an impact on the people that he met here in Vancouver. During my time, you wouldn't see many players that were more beloved by support staff, training staff, teammates, and the hardest group to sell is the coaching staff. And if he were here today, I can assure you that Alain Vigneault's favorite player probably, except when Roberto Luongo was making big saves, in his 14 years was Rick Rypien. I hope Wes realizes just the soft spot that Alain had for his brother, because it was genuine. As I say, Rick joined the organization in 2006, and for the first two or three seasons, as far as everybody that was close to the club knew, everything was fine. Prior to training camp in 2008, Rick confided in a small group of us, Mike Bernstein, the head medical trainer, myself, and a few others, that he was struggling with depression and that he had been for quite some time. This was a very courageous thing for Rick to do. And I can assure you that the Canucks organization did everything they possibly could to put Rick in a position to succeed with his mental health. So over the course of the next couple years, Rick spent some time in Vancouver. He spent some time playing on this ice. And at times he took leaves of absence to deal with his mental health in an environment that is far less intrusive and pressure-filled as playing in this arena. It was about 2010 that Rick and I had a lunch that I'll never forget. We spent nearly 3 hours talking about his depression, about many things that he had experienced in his lifetime. But by far the most impactful thing that Rick said to me that day was that he did intend to get healthy and get well and to tell his story publicly. And as the director of media relations at the time, I was going to try and help him tell that story. And we worked on a plan. And he understood how vulnerable he would be and how courageous he would need to be to do that. But at the right time, he wanted to do that with one sole purpose, and that was to tell young people that if they were feeling the same things he was feeling, that it was okay to ask for help, that people wanted to help. Sadly, in the summer of 2011, Wes lost his brother, and we lost a very good friend. And I can assure you that, just speaking for myself, we were devastated personally. Rick had made a profound impact on this organization. And that evening, I texted Kevin Bieksa, who was Rick's closest friend on the Canucks, and I assured him that we would find a way that Rick was never forgotten. And all of you sitting here today is proof that Rick has not been forgotten. So thank you for that. Shortly after Rick passed, myself and a number of my colleagues met with our friends at BC Children's Hospital and BC Mental Health Addiction Services, and they made us aware of a website called mindcheck.ca. It was a pilot website at the time, and it was going to relaunch in January of 2012, and I knew immediately this was the perfect place where we could fulfill Rick's goals and start to create the legacy that he deserves. So on that, in January of 2012, mindcheck.ca relaunched. The Canucks were very heavily involved. Kevin Bieksa was the face of the In One Voice video. And I would like to show you not only that video, but the hundreds of people that started to add their voice to the pledge.
I'm the friend of someone who suffered from depression.
I know it isn't a choice.
It's not a weakness, self-inflicted.
Inflicted or the result of not trying.
Sometimes
you just can't get over it.
It won't just go away.
Pretending it didn't happen.
Pain doesn't help. Talking about it does.
Getting support early can make the difference.
Seeking help does not make you weak. It makes you strong.
Helping someone you care about is
not a burden.
Helping is talking, caring, and most importantly, listening.
Listen to what your children are saying, but also what they are not saying.
Learning to recognize the signs in others is important because sometimes asking for help is one of the hardest things to do.
There are people who feel the same way. There are people who want to help.
I want to help in any way that I can.
I pledge to learn the signs.
I will not judge.
I will have compassion.
I will reach out, listen,
talk, help,
and find help.
My name is Kevin Biexa.
My name is Aaliyah.
My name is Steven.
My name is Cheryl.
And we will not stay silent.
Kids Fund and the Canucks were honored to be part of the relaunch of mycheck.ca, and as the statistics showed, immediately following the relaunch, hundreds of people started adding their voice and thousands of people started taking a self-assessment quiz. But at the Canucks organization, we wanted to continue to build on the work that was being done and continue to build on Rick's legacy. And collectively, we came up with an idea for something called Hockey Talks. And the idea was that if the Canucks had the voice in Vancouver and across British Columbia, that surely the other six teams in Canada had the same voice in their city and across their province. And we are thrilled to say that each of them were willing to partner with us. And last year in February of 2013, Wes dropped the puck before a Chicago Blackhawks Canucks game right here at Rogers Arena for the first Hockey Talks night in the National Hockey League, a night dedicated to building mental health awareness. And this past year, the Canucks continued that on with their six partners, and all seven teams recognized mental health awareness in January of 2014. And I'm hopeful, before I left the organization, I had stated that the goal was to have a league-wide 30-team initiative that would be a month-long awareness campaign for mental health, and I hope that that work will continue. This time last year, just to give you a background on why we're all here today, this time last year, Kevin Biexa and I attended the Youth Summit 2013 at BC Children's Hospital, and there were about 160 or 180 very engaged youth just like yourself, and I can speak for Kevin and I, it was a tremendous experience to see people so committed to not only their own mental well-being, but the mental well-being of others. I turned to Dr. Connie Colignio that afternoon and I said, why don't we host that at Rogers Arena next year for a couple thousand kids? And after I picked her up off the floor, she agreed. So here we are. I'm thrilled to be here. Thank you for being here. This building will be full one day. Rick's legacy will live on. I'm grateful that Wes is here, and I will now introduce Paul Irving. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Wow, this is pretty exciting. This is a pretty surreal moment for me, and it's a surreal moment for me for a number of reasons. One of them I find particularly cool is I've been lucky enough to go around with TC and a couple other people from the Canucks and do these mind check talks at high schools around Vancouver. And every time I hear people close to Rick speak, hearing Wes, hearing TC, hearing Kevin Biexa speak, I feel like I get to know Rick a little better every single time, and I never met him personally, but I feel like I get to know him better every single time. And one thing I always take away from every single time I do these speeches was his desire to help youth, his desire to help people who were struggling with something that he was struggling with. So when I'm up here today, I feel like I'm staring Rick's legacy right in the face, right in all of your faces. So. Can we get another round of applause for the Canucks and for yourselves for being here? Uh, So I guess that brings me to why I'm here, why I'm up on the stage. It all started about a year and 6 months ago. I was approached by Brent and Sarah, our lovely facilitators for the day, and they came up to me and said they were doing a video series, and they wanted kids to tell, or youth to tell their story. And at the end of the story, they wanted there to be a theme. They wanted there to be a message. And so I was allowed to sleep on it, have a couple days, think about what I wanted my message to be. And so I got very introspective. I thought, you know, it's going to be something deep and meaningful. But when I thought about it, it was really simple. What do I want to tell high school me? What would I want to tell me when I was in high school, when I was struggling? And it was simple. Talk about it. Communicate. Open your mouth. Say something. It was as simple as that, because that little thing, opening up, changed my life forever. So I guess that brings me to my story. I remember very distinctly the first time I was getting these feelings. It was between the summer of grade 7 and 8. And I was standing outside playing basketball at my house. And I remember feeling so sad. Just so down and sad. And I know everyone goes through their ups and downs. I mean, we all go through our rough patches in lives. Things happen. You can't control that. But there was no real reason I could pin on how down I felt. I shouldn't be waking up in the morning and wishing I didn't. I shouldn't feel that down. So I didn't understand mental health. And I went through phases where I would give reasons for it in my own head. I would think, well, this is completely normal. I guess everyone just goes through this. I guess everyone feels this way. It's just part of growing up. It's just part of being a person. Then I would think, you know, maybe this is just part of puberty. And then I thought, well, puberty sucks. And there was no warning for this at all. And then I'd go through phases where I'd think I'm completely crazy, that no one else could possibly feel the way I felt, that I was different from everybody else. And so what happened is I continued all the way through high school. And I did it quietly. I didn't tell a single soul, because the only thing that was scarier to me than what I was feeling was telling anybody in my life. And it didn't matter who it was, anybody. So, you know, I played sports. I did okay in school. I had my friends, and I just went along. I put a smile on my face despite everything I was feeling inside. And that went on all the way to the end of high school. And the first time I told somebody is a bit of a weird story, because I never planned to. It still was the scariest thing I could imagine. But it was one day I decided I was going to McGill University. And I was in the car with my mom, and she looked at me, and we were driving downtown. And she said, "Paul, you must be so excited to go to Montreal, go to McGill, it's going to be great." And verbal diarrhea just came out of my mouth, and I said, "I don't know, I'm not doing very well, I don't know how excited I am." And it felt weird, and I don't know why I did it, but it felt like I just took a huge weight off my back, like someone took a monkey off my back. And the reaction from my parents wasn't necessarily the greatest reaction. They didn't understand mental health, but that wasn't it. It was the fact that someone else knew, the fact that I wasn't fighting it alone. So we decided, you know what, I'm still going to go to McGill, I'm still going to go to Montreal. So I went, and I had an unbelievable amount of fun. I met some friends, some experiences I'll never forget. But what carried around me the whole entire time was these feelings of sadness. They never went away. This depression, this cloud above me never left. Until one day, I decided I couldn't do it any longer. And I stepped outside the window of my dorm room on the fifth floor, and there was rocks below, and I said, "I'm gonna jump." And I stepped outside the window, and I got a phone call, and a phone call from a friend, and I stepped back inside, and I answered it. And the irony that I realized later was the thing that saved me from something I wouldn't talk about was a phone call. And that moment I realized, you know what? I'm not safe. I need to go home. So I told my parents, you know what? This is too much. I'm not safe by myself out here. I need to go home. And so that's what we did. And I was going to go see a doctor, and we were going to deal with this. And I felt really good about that. And then I realized, oh no, I have to tell all of my friends why I'm coming home. Because I just came back from Christmas telling them, Montreal's the greatest place in the world. I'm never going to leave. Woo! Basically that. And I thought, how am I going to tell them? I mean, these people are going to think I'm crazy. They're never going to be friends with me ever again. And I was thinking of excuses I was going to make up, different reasons, just blaming it on someone else or anything. And then I decided, you know what? I'm gonna come clean about this. So I did. I told them that I was struggling with depression and anxiety, and that's why I came home. And I wasn't safe out there. And the same thing with my parents. It wasn't about their reaction. It was the fact that they knew, and I wasn't at this alone. I had opened myself out there, and they knew that I was the same kid they had known. I was the same Paul they had known their whole entire lives. But then something cooler happened that I never expected. Every single one of my friends that I had told came up to me over the next couple months and shared something unbelievably personal about themselves. A lot of it had to do with mental health. Some of it had to do with something that was going on in their families, some issues. Maybe it was something with their parents. Maybe it was something with their friend, a brother, a sister. But they opened up to me about something very, very personal. And what I realized was everyone wants to talk about it, but we're all too scared to do it. And the only thing I had done when I had come and told them was I built a bridge. I'd built a bridge, I'd put myself out there, and then they felt comfortable to do the same with me. And I still believe the things I told them, they haven't told each other to this day. But I had built that bridge with them, and they decided to walk over. And even further than that, it's been about a year, 2 years since I had told them. And to think that I'd be up on the stage in front of a couple thousand people and have them texting me, supporting me, excited, wanting to talk about mental health, it's quite something. And so if I had one thing to say to any of you guys is tell somebody, talk to somebody, whether it's an aunt, uncle, grandma, grandpa, mom, dad, friend, sister, brother, cousin, counselor, teacher, anybody in your life, just talk. Open up that bridge and see what happens. So my challenge to you guys for the day, and you'll get a few of them, is think about that. Try and build your own bridge. Try and build your own line of communication. And it may not be you opening up to someone else. It may be simple as going up to a friend you think is having a hard time and saying, hey, I'm here if you want to talk. Or, how are you doing? Something as simple as that. And trust me, it'll be pretty magical what you get back. Anyway, thank you very much. I'm Paul Irving. It's a wonderful honor to be up here with TC and Wes Rypien talking about mindcheck.ca. And yeah, I'm excited for the rest of the day.
Again, to the Canucks and Wes and TC and Paul for sharing your stories and why you're passionate about being here today. I think that talking about our mental health is something that we all hope to do better after today is over.
And this, it's not just talking about your mental health when you're struggling. This is a tool you can use when you're doing well. You want people, this is something in my recovery that I was doing was trying to find people in relationships that I could rely on in good times and bad, so you can, you know, be supportive. supported by them and encouraged in the tough times, but celebrate with them in the good times. And when you have people around you that support you in that way, it can really boost you in those tough times, and it makes those great times even better. So that's an incredible message. I always love to hear from Paul, and he's an inspiring individual. Putting himself out there, it takes courage to do that, and I respect him for that.